The geopolitical divide in the Pacific is deepening, with blocs around China and the United States competing for influence. America's top diplomat for East Asia and the Pacific has just been in New Zealand, fresh from a trip to Beijing, where he met with Chinese counterparts. Daniel Kritenbrink sat down with One News Pacific correspondent Barbara Dreaver for this exclusive interview.
In Singapore, your Defence Secretary Lloyd Austin did rebuke China for refusing to hold military talks. Did you make any headway on that?
Well, unfortunately, no, but I was equally candid as the Secretary of Defense had been about our concern that we think it's unacceptable that we don't have open channels of communication in the military-to-military space as well. And look, our view is we don't engage in dialogue as a favor to either party. We do this because this is how responsible nations ought to engage. I actually think it's unfortunate and potentially dangerous that our militaries aren't talking with one another. And we have a lot to talk about, including, as you saw, some of the recent unsafe maneuvers that we've seen on the part of the People's Liberation Army.
So how do you walk away from that meeting?
I walk away from my meeting in Beijing pleased in the sense that we had the engagement because it was constructive, productive, exceptionally candid. But I also walk away with a continued sense of realism about where we are with this relationship. There will be continued tension. There are fundamental differences between our two countries. I think we have to recognize that as the reality that we face.
The United States is gathering in allies, partners, friends. It's never been so critical as the U.S.-China divide deepens.
Thank God for our partnership with New Zealand. New Zealand, just like the United States of America, is part of the Pacific. And we really benefit from, I think, the wisdom and the wise counsel that our friends in New Zealand provide to us. No substitute, of course, to engaging directly with all of our Pacific partners, but we certainly benefit from the advice and counsel of our friends here in New Zealand. I come here to engage in some very serious business as well. New Zealand is an incredibly capable and important partner, a strategic partner.
What are the challenges of working with a country like ours that has such a strong anti-nuclear stance?
I would like to think that we have overcome those challenges. Our history is what it is, and there's much to celebrate there, and there's some challenges as well. I think we've overcome them, and I think the way I see this partnership is we are largely like-minded in the values that we share. There's so much we can do together. Like two sovereign countries, we'll have some differences, of course. We'll work through those, too.
Last year, Chinese Foreign Minister Wang Li went on a 10-country Pacific tour, signing up multiple bilateral agreements amid the regional battle for influence. The United States and ally Australia hastily followed with diplomatic visits of their own. Just weeks ago, the US and Papua New Guinea signed a cooperative defence deal which will allow American forces access to the island nation. That, along with Australia's plan to buy 8 nuclear-powered submarines through AUKUS, a trilateral security pact with the US and UK, has resulted in regional anxiety about militarization of the Pacific.
We're focused on promoting peace and prosperity across the region. We are not interested in militarizing the region. And I would say the vast majority of the time that we spend engaging with Pacific leaders is on the priorities. And it's mostly about fisheries and climate and economic development. We do talk candidly about all issues, including security as well. It's hard to have, I think, development and prosperity without security, but I think no one has an interest in raising tensions across the region. But I think we have to be honest and candid about the situation as we see it as well.
Yes, of course, no one wants to see the militarization, yeah. But it is happening nonetheless. We have the AUKUS deal in Australia with nuclear submarines. Mm-hmm. Pacific leaders are upset about it. Mm-hmm. We've got the PNG defence deal. Mm-hmm. You know, so do you understand how they are feeling, the leaders are feeling?
Well, I think what I would say is this, Barbara. We've been present in this region for decades. So we believe that we've been the constant background presence. So I'm not sure that we would somehow see that America is contributing to militarization in the region. The way that we're trying to approach it, for example, with Papua New Guinea and the new defense cooperation agreement that folks have been talking about, we've had a defense partnership with Papua New Guinea since 1975, and in many ways the DCA is really just a refreshing and modernization of that, and that will be done in a very transparent way. It has been thus far, and you'll see even more of that as it goes forward. And then, look, on AUKUS, I would say this. AUKUS is an important partnership that is going to develop and produce and provide a new capability to our friends in Australia related to submarines with nuclear propulsion. It has nothing to do with nuclear weapons, but with propulsion, and is designed specifically to contribute to peace and security and stability across the region. But look, Barbara, we know that there have been questions about AUKUS, and that's why we've engaged, I think, so intensively across the Pacific and across Southeast Asia and elsewhere. My sense is that more recently, I think countries have an understanding of what AUKUS is and is not, and what it's really about.
You talked about the U.S. has been engaged in the Pacific, or
yes,
but in the past. But isn't it fair to say that actually the U.S. has been missing in action for the past few decades, and hasn't done as much as it should?
I wouldn't phrase it that way. I don't think that's accurate. What I think is accurate is to say that we've decided it's very much in our interest to step up our game. And we have attempted to do that. I'd like to think that we've done that successfully, and we're going to keep at it. We're going to do that at a pace that's comfortable with our Pacific Island friends, and we're only going to do what our Pacific Island friends ask us to do and want us to do. And that's why we have, I think, such close and regular dialogue with them.
In World War II, there were battles fought, and in Kiribati, for example, the Battle of Tarawa, and the U.S.
Even kids like me growing up studying that history, we know all of these names because of the sacrifices we made together.
Well, I grew up there too. I'm half Kiribati, so I understand the issue.
Of course.
And, you know, that vision of war, when they didn't cause it, is causing anxiety in the region.
Yeah.
You know, how do you engage with Pacific countries when that vision is very much there?
We recognize that sacrifice. I think we celebrate and we honor it. But we never want to see that kind of a situation again. And so when I see and feel and sense that strong demand signal for American engagement, I think friends in the Pacific want that engagement. So as I said earlier, that America continues to play that stabilizing role. It is not in anyone's interest to have a conflict, and whether there's a conflict in the Pacific or anywhere else, you know, it will be a disaster for all concerned.
For the second time, President Biden will host Pacific leaders at the White House later in the year. The superpower has also pledged US $600 million over the decade to combat illegal fishing, boost maritime security, and tackle climate change. Another $7 billion is proposed for the Marshall Islands, Micronesia, and Palau, which are all in free association with America. New embassies are being set up around the region, and Peace Corps is returning.
The challenges of the 21st century are only growing, and security is only a small part of that. I would argue climate change is probably the most urgent challenge, but so are issues related to fisheries and economic development as well.
Pacific leaders do say that climate change is their biggest security threat.
So.
But the U.S. is one of the biggest emitters of greenhouse gases. Mm-hmm. So what would you say to those concerned leaders and countries?
What I would say is we hear you. We're your partner. This is why we've come back to the Paris Agreement. This is why under President Biden's leadership we've made such bold commitments to reduce our own emissions, which I think are quite dramatic, and it's why we're trying to lead the global diplomacy to make sure all countries, whether it's China or other large emitters, meet their obligations and show sufficient ambition, because this truly is a crisis, and we have to treat it as such. And it's quite interesting. I think for our Pacific friends, this is an existential crisis, one that they're not contributing to because they're not the emitters. They're the ones suffering most from it.
As the US hopes to win hearts and minds across the Pacific, island nations have made it very clear they are friends to all, enemies to none. Kiribati has extremely close political and diplomatic ties to China, and the Solomon Islands has signed a security pact with Beijing, the details of which are a secret.
Every country has the sovereign right to make their own decisions. We recognize that. That's a fact of life. We want to make sure that remains the case going forward. But I think together with other friends in the Pacific, we want to make sure that when decisions are made, they're done in a transparent way, and they're done in a way that's reassuring to the rest of the region and doesn't cause concern or anxiety or undermine the peace and security that we all desire.
You'll do it better.
Well,
is that what you're saying?
Well, we'd like to think so. We do. I mean, look, what do we stand for? Look, we're Americans. We're not perfect. We're an open book. You can pick up the newspapers or watch our TV programs every day. The one thing that makes me most proud to be an American, though, is because we are an open book. We do learn from our mistakes. At least we try. We talk about striving to form a more perfect union. And we also try to reflect on our history, including across this region. We are more committed than ever to this fact. Our future lies in the Pacific and in the broader Asia-Pacific and Indo-Pacific. It's in our interest to have the most successful partners in this region and to maintain the peace and stability that's been here for decades. That's what we're all about.